폭염이 이어지던 8월의 아침, 무더위도 어쩌지 못하는 중학생 영어 토론 대회가 올해도 어김없이 시작됐습니다. YTN과 한국외대가 공동 주최하는 이 대회는 학생들에게 영어 실력을 넘어 논리력과 창의력, 협업 능력까지 요구합니다. 우리 학생들이 이렇게나 힘든 호랑이 굴을 제 발로 찾는 이유는 뭘까요?
한국외국어대학교랑 YTN이 공동 주최하는 큰 대회다 보니까 이게 전국 각지에서 이제 90팀 정도 모였다고 하죠, 올해. 그래서 90팀이 이렇게 서로 이렇게 겨뤄보면서 자신의 실력이 전국에서 상위 몇 프로나 되는지 이렇게 체크할 수 있는 그런 되게 큰 공식적인 대회라고 생각을 해요.
일단 규모가 되게 크고 그러면은 심판들도 되게 피드백 같은 거 잘 주시고 좀 그 음료 같은 것도 잘 챙겨주고 여러모로 좋은 것 같아요.
YTN 일단 되게 기본적으로 그 저지들이나 그러신 분들이 되게 그 훌륭하신 분들이 많이 오고 그리고 되게 그 본선 라운드도 되게 주제들도 되게 그 CA 분들이나 만드신 분들이 되게 깊게 되게 잘 재밌게 그러니까 좋은 주제로 요즘 연관성 있는 시사성 있는 그런 주제로 되게 잘 만드세요.
토론 대회의 명가로 자리 잡은 데는 그만한 이유가 있었네요. 올해는 전국 중학생 91개 팀 총 273명이 참가해서 열띤 경쟁을 예고했습니다. 화기애애한 분위기 속에서 대회에 막이 올랐습니다.
오늘 대회에서 만난 친구들은 단지 여러분의 경쟁자가 아닙니다. 가까운 미래에 어쩌면 세계 무대에서 함께 뛰면서 서로에게 힘이 되어줄 동료들입니다. 매 경기 승패에 연연하지 마시고 새로운 친구들과 기쁘게 만나고 축제처럼 대회를 즐겨줬으면 좋겠습니다.
2010년 첫 돌을 맞았던 중등부 대회는 어느새 10주년을 코앞에 두고 있습니다.
점점 이제 세월이 지나갈수록 아이들이 이 토론에 대한 관심을 좀 갖게 되고 또 영어로 토론을 한다라고 하는 것에서 두려움과 호기심과 이런 것들이 같이 있었지만 점점 더 학생들의 마음에 영어로 내가 토론하는 것에 대해서 자부심을 가지고 또 도전해볼 만한 것이다라고 하는 생각을 갖게 되는 것 같아요. 그리고 무엇보다도 외국 경험이 별로 많지 않은 학생들이 영어 토론에 좀 더 많은 관심을 가지고 점차 진입하고 있다라고 하는 것이 굉장히 고무적인 일이다라고 생각을 하고 있습니다.
분주하게 예선전을 준비하는 학생들. 어느새 장난기 가득하던 모습은 사라지고 진지하게 자신만의 논리를 펼치고 있습니다. 잠깐 대회 방식을 알아볼까요? 이 대회는 정부 역을 맡은 찬성팀과 야당 역을 맡은 반대팀이 논거를 번갈아 연설하는 의회식 토론 방식을 따릅니다. 다양한 즉흥 주제를 놓고 총 5번의 리그전을 치러야 이튿날 열리는 본선 토너먼트에 진출할 수 있습니다. 예열은 끝나고 드디어 예선전의 시작입니다. 심판은 토론자의 발언을 화술, 내용, 전략의 측면에서 종합적으로 평가합니다.
일단 여러 가지를 중점에 두는데 저 같은 경우에는 두 가지를 보는 것 같아요. 첫 번째로는 토론이라는 건 아무래도 한 팀이 발표를 한 다음에 다른 팀이 발표를 하다 보니까 상대 팀에 대한 뭐 대답이나 대응 같은 걸 보기도 하고 그리고 두 번째로는 첫 번째 스피커부터 마지막 스피커까지 얼마나 연결되는지 그 연속성의 내용을 보는 것 같아요. 네.
밤늦도록 치른 경기 끝에 드디어 본선 진출자가 확정됐습니다.
Congratulations, Linda 2004. Team Twitter, congratulations.
와, 진출의 단맛과 네, 탈락의 쓴맛이 교차하는 순간이네요.
이렇게 본선 진출해서 너무 행복하고 그냥 내일 결과가 어떻게 되든 그냥 행복하게 마무리하겠습니다.
기쁨도 아쉬움도 뒤로 한 채 영어 토론 대회가 이튿날을 맞았습니다. 치열한 설전 끝에 결승 무대에 오른 두 팀을 만나볼 차례입니다. 정부역의 찬성팀은 팀 트리니티, 야당역의 반대팀은 팀 프리도미넌트. 이들이 본격 맞대결할 결승 주제는 과연 무엇일까요? 시간을 사고파는 기술이 존재한다고 가정할 때 정부는 개인들이 자신의 남은 인생을 사고팔 수 있게 할 것이다. 결승전답게 수준이 남다른데요. 보기만 해도 어려운 이 주제로 첫 연설을 할 학생은 누구일까요?
준이는 그 제 쌍둥이이기도 한데 되게 그 첫 번째 역할을 맡아서 되게 그 처음에 저희 주장을 처음부터까지 되게 자세하고 그 되게 실용적이게 왜 이게 중요한 일이고 또한 실용적인 그런 그 좋은 점 또한 갖고 있는지 되게 자세히 설명해야 되고 특히 그러한 점에서 조금 이해력이 되게 좋고 그런 걸 되게 설명을 잘 해줍니다.
쌍둥이가 보증하는 찬성팀의 첫 주자 정부 수상역을 맡은 이준희 학생의 발언입니다.
So ladies and gentlemen, as a government side, we would like to propose a detailed policy for this motion. First argument is about the freedom of choice. Madam Speaker and Mr. Speaker, we're living in a capitalistic society that cherishes the private ownership of and the right to profit. In such a system, there is always a separation between the winners and losers. In other words, the rich and the poor. We understand that the government cannot eradicate such a system because it is the foundation of our development. Without capitalism, it is not easy to maintain current prosperity. This means government is maintaining a status quo by sacrificing certain groups of people. Given the fact that government cannot eradicate capitalism, which inevitably creates the rich and the poor, we believe that government should not take away options which can improve the life to arbitrary moral standards of the government. Then how does people selling time makes their life better? In today's society, quality of life is much more important than the longevity of life or being in the existence in itself. We believe that such ideals gaining the strength in the existences of instances of being in instances of itself. We see such ideals of gaining strength in instances of euthanasia and people consuming harmful substances. Some people who get incurable disease even refuse to get treatment, which can cure or increase the length of life, of their life. Because happiness is subjective, many people see different value on different things. No, thank you, ma'am. If people care about longevity of life, they will not consume harmful substances or do euthanasia. But when people care about quality of life or quantity of life, then they will choose differently. We believe that there are many cases that people can be happy if they sell their life or time to get money. Our second argument is about how it benefits the poor. We believe that there will be physical benefits also. So the opposition team argues that people should not live less amount of time, but I'm going to prove to you why under our policy, people will live longer. The reason why poor live less right now is that they have unhealthy lifestyle. To live longer, you need money, you need good and healthy food, you should not get too much stress from the workplace, you should exercise time to time, which requires money. Two, you should also have entertainment to release stress, which requires a lot of money too. So at the end of the day, you know what? All these things need a lot of money at the end of the day. So under our policy, people can consume and have healthy life if they have money. Furthermore, these poor can also use money to get higher education. These days, many countries do not provide free university education for all. We believe that this is a problem. No high good university education deters social mobility. Poor stays poor because their ladder was removed by the society. But under our policy, they can buy better university education. Then in the future, next generations do not have to be poor like their parents. So our last argument is going to be about how this motion empowers the poor members of society through political power. Currently, the gap between the rich and the poor is not only perpetuated through the discrepancy of the capital, but also through a lack of political influence in government institutions. This is primarily due to the lacking capacity of poor people to provide political donations through their representatives. This leads to unfortunate tragedy of where the people who require the most attention receive the least care. We can solve this problem through this policy by firstly, now under our model, poor people of the society can also provide political donations, which makes the donors cannot be ignored. So therefore, Madam and Mr. Speaker, we are proud to propose. Thank you.
정부 수상역의 이준희 학생은 선택의 자유와 행복의 주관성, 빈곤층의 권리를 논거로 들어 정책에 찬성하는 연설을 펼쳤습니다. 그럼 이번엔 반대팀 토론자의 소개를 들어볼까요?
저희 팀 First Speaker 민진이는 일단은 그 처음에 케이스를 만들 때도 굉장히 디베이트를 뭐 오래 해서 그런 것도 있고 그냥 원독도 머리가 좋은 것도 있겠지만 좋은 아이디어도 많이 만들어주고 또 그런 아이디어를 굉장히 논리적으로 표현할 수 있고 또 그 굉장히 개념적인 설명들을 굉장히 추상적인 개념들도 굉장히 자세하고 논리적으로 잘 설명해 주는 것 같아요. 뭐 논리도 그렇고 말투나 어조 같은 것도 진짜 first speaker로는 가장 완벽한 친구인 것 같아요.
논리부터 화법까지 완벽하다. 야당 대표 역을 맡은 김민진 학생의 발언입니다.
Honorable Chair, we see a clear-cut distinction between changing how you live and changing your existence itself. You can make choices which are, for instance, stressful, but you can't sell your organs, thus affect your very existence. We will prove to you in this debate why this technology goes against the basic human sanctity along the same line with the example stated above and also causes practical harms. Opposition bench supports the complete ban and removal of this policy. And before moving on to opposition case, let's start by refuting some arguments from the Prime Minister. Second of all, they told us about how people should choose how they live. Ladies and gentlemen, if you can always choose how you want to live, are you willing to allow slavery or organ trade? We think limits are necessary when outcomes result in direct harms. And third of all, they told us about how it's going to benefit the poor. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a government duty to guarantee these through welfare instead of forcing people to give up their lifetime to buy them themselves. It is on how it objectifies life. If a value is placed on a person's remaining life, it effectively puts a price tag that quantifies the value of life. We believe that the value of life cannot be and should never be measured in monetary terms. The development of human rights and relevant efforts to protect them were and are based on the key premise that human lives are vested with innate and inalienable rights. This motion fundamentally challenges this premise and will cause the international effort to improve human rights to lose momentum and backtrack. Secondly, is on why there needs to be a limit on transactional freedoms. The motion at hand is principally different from selling goods or providing labor. But even in such cases, there are limits to what can be traded based on human dignity. As in the case of lethal weapons or drugs, people are not allowed to buy or sell these products that can potentially threat human lives or health. There are also limits to jobs or working conditions, regardless of mutual consent. The state banned slavery or indentured servitude unconditionally in a motion where the obvious and only outcome results in discontinuation of life, it must not be allowed. Second level of analysis, it will worsen redistribution and the sense of relative deprivation in the poor. In the status quo, the ultimate equalizer of all human being is death. It is the only one single conclusion that all men are predestined to. It will create a huge sense of relative deprivation when only the poor are subjected to the terrifying fate, while the rich can now even get rid of this fate. In addition to this moral dilemma, we think it also has very realistic implications. The state redistributes most of the deceased property through inheritance tax. However, when the rich lives practically forever, the state loses one very important mechanism of redistribution, thereby harming social equality and once again further fixating the wealth gap. Moving on to our third argument about time expectancy. Existential value is best appreciated when individuals are uncertain about their destiny. Existence of this technology naturally means that people would be aware of the time that is left for themselves. The beauty of life will also suffer from decreased appreciation level, leading to less motivation and less incentive to take best use of their lifetime. People strive to use best of their lifetime in the status quo because they do not know when they will die. Now, they can waste time because they know when they'll die, and they can refuse to be productive with their work and their life. So as a result, ladies and gentlemen, we believe that the government then will have a hard time regulating consumption of things like drugs and et cetera. And for these reasons, we are more than proud to oppose today's debate. Thank you.
야당 대표 역의 김민진 학생은 정부 정책이 빈부격차를 확대하고 빈곤층의 인권을 해칠 수 있다며 반대 연설을 펼쳤습니다. 이번엔 찬성팀이 반격할 차례입니다. 다음 토론자 소개를 들어볼까요?
민선은 두 번째 스피커로서 많은 그 다른 팀의 허점이나 그런 걸 잘 짚어주고 또 저희의 마지막 주장을 설명하는 역할로서 매우 잘 설명하고요. 너무 팀워크가 잘 돼요. 네.
상대의 허점은 절대 놓치지 않는다. 정부 부수상 역을 맡은 조민서 학생의 발언입니다.
I'm to have a several rebuttals to their case. Number one, they basically talked about because we rather have to provide a welfare to these poor people, this is going to be evading of some sort of responsibility of the state. What our first speaker was not talking about, we can have a bread by having this policy. Rather, what we're having is that basically above the minimum quality of life, that there weren't any access of these poor people to actually go to a higher quality of life, like having a more money that makes you to have a rich life, when basically in the status quo, just we see that how 70 years life does not simply always mean that you're happy, where you're simply working, where you're basically slave of the capitalism, where you simply have to work for all the time, when they never talked about how they're going to able to solve the basic problem of capitalism, how losers and winners always exist above the level of the minimum quality of life. We've already told you how happiness of life is subjective. Not simply breeding and sustaining your life does not simply mean to all of your happiness. That's why we've told you how giving a more option. We've told you this is not simply mandatizing all poor people to go for this option. Because all people have a different opinions and different ideas or subjective values regarding the quality of your life. The state must guarantee as long as they can never solve the fundamental problem of the capitalism sure. when they cannot earn such amount of money. We see that's a problematic. Yes, ma'am.
Won't it actually force these people just to sell their lives and do nothing else?
Number one, we've already told you our policy is exactly educating or telling the information about these poor people. We're not simply saying that, boom, one day you sell your time. Rather, what we're saying is we're going to give them counselors for all of these transactions and procedures, which means that they're not going to simply waste their time without any information. That's the reason why we've already told you how the freedom of choice is guaranteed under our side of us, rather because we are also going to alert these people regarding the harms that they're likely to have. Furthermore, they talked about how inheritance tax is something a distributive system in the status quo. But firstly, we question side opposition. Why should always a death as a mean of redistribution? Because we see how still the rich people are going to pay the taxes and how these type of redistribution system are still going to exist. But furthermore, we have to understand how more political opportunities are given to these poor people. The Movement 13's final case, how this will change the concept of the time for these people. So basically, already in the status quo, people view the concept of time itself, and this is going to be changed under our side of ours. In the status quo, the concept of time is something that we inevitably feel distant from because it only exists in an abstract form, ladies and gentlemen. Since it is hard for us to accurately think and understand and evaluate the weight and significance of it, we end up simply underrating the value of our future time, especially when it comes to when your life has like 60 or 70 years. That's in the situation we cannot really sense our time, ending up in a situation without you recognizing the importance, you simply waste your time. What we're saying is that waste of time is always not, we're not saying it's bad. What we're saying is that without you really realizing the importance of time, you simply end up in a situation where we simply think that this is taken for granted. Although this is a limited source of resources in the status quo, we have to understand that how this leads to a positive check where people become more responsible in terms of using their time.
정부 부수상역의 조민서 학생은 자본주의의 본질적인 문제를 정부가 나서서 해결해야 한다며 이 정책을 통해 부를 재분배할 수 있다고 연설했습니다. 반대팀도 가만히 있을 순 없겠죠? 다음 토론자는 누구일까요?
저희 팀 문우는 Deputy Speaker이고요. 굉장히 반박을 할 때 남들이 생각하지 못한 참신한 의견들을 많이 내는 것이 장점이라고 생각을 합니다. 또한 조리 있게 말해서 되게 차분하게 말하는 능력을 닮고 싶어서 항상 은우 스피치를 열심히 듣는 것 같아요.
톡톡 튀는 아이디어로 승부한다. 야당 부대표 역을 맡은 최은우 학생의 발언입니다.
Mr. Madam Speaker, before we move on to our last argument, which is going to talk about actual economic harms that this policy is going to actually create to the society and the status quo, let's first of all talk about this issue in two main perspectives, right? Then let's first of all talk about whether or not happiness is a subjective value, and even for that, we can actually sacrifice the right to life, right? So even if proselytization allows you to actually earn a lot of money and actually allows you to pursue your lifestyle and whatnot, we clearly think that even if those kind of proselytization or whatnot, or organ trade or whatnot is done under the both sides' consent, we do not allow it in the status quo because we believe that there is a human dignity, that is a line that government should not actually allow people to pursue, right? Especially since this is the act of the government, we do not ban suicide even if you pursue death, right? We clearly think that especially in this kind of cases where government role is to actually judge upon the principle bias as well as the hierarchy of rights, right? So even if we agree upon the point that right to pursue happiness exists, and it is rather important, within the compared to the right to life, we clearly think that the right to life must stand in a higher place, and therefore we clearly think that this policy actually allows you to sacrifice your right to life in the time that you actually choose to sell, right? Now let's talk about who better tackles the vicious cycle at the end of the day, right? Okay, number one, we clearly think that even if the counseling is provided to this kind of poor people, we think that if you actually get a lump sum of money in one moment, and by sacrificing a value that you don't actually feel right in skin, right? We don't actually feel the value that we actually gave up to in order to gain that lump sum of money, and therefore we don't think that they're going to realize the cost that they have paid unless they actually reach the moment in which they die, and then we think that that's the moment in which they become to regret their own choice, right? We think that is exactly why it is. It would not their policy would not actually ensure their rational usage of money. And second of all, we clearly think that there was only one line announcement coming from their prime minister saying that if you actually get a lot of money, you're going to invest in businesses or universities, and then you're suddenly going to lift off your poverty state, right? We think that is a very flawed analysis coming from their side, because the fact that you actually are able to go into university, it does not necessarily ensure your success. And if those kind of investments fails, we think that's the moment in which the poor goes into the vicious cycle again, right? And third of all, we clearly think that even if these people are given a lump sum of money that they can actually utilize well in terms of pursuing their own lifestyles, we think that is the moment in which they're not going to look for jobs in the status quo that requires hard labor, which is also part of the society, which I'm going to further elaborate in my argument, right? We think that because selling time is much more beneficial and earns much more money in terms of actually them working in that time, we think that it's going to decrease their incentive for them to actually find the work and actually become productive members of society, which ultimately also harms the society at the end of the day, right? And let's move on to our last argument, which is basically going to consider the realistic economic consequences of this motion, right? Okay, first of all, this will result in a breakdown of society, right? In the status quo, people work in order to maintain a living. Wages are earned through various different jobs based on one's preferences, circumstances, or skills. And although occupations differ, many jobs also perform a social role as well, right? Farmers, construction workers, and firefighters all perform a unique function that is essential for the society to actually work, right? However, many of these socially necessary roles are extremely demanding and labor intensive, right? We think that this sale of time is going to lead into since people can now significantly improve the quality of their lives without risking their lives or actually doing this kind of hard labor, we think that it leads into deterioration of social infrastructure because people are not going to work in those kind of hard labor jobs and whatnot. We think that it's going to, in realistic economic perspective, this newly gained wealth will result in gradual breakdown of society, right?
야당 부대표 역의 최은우 학생은 정부의 정책이 인간의 존엄성을 지키며 사회 권리를 침해할 수 있으며 정책이 잘못될 경우엔 사회적 기반까지 악화하리라고 반박했습니다. 이제 찬성팀 마지막 주자의 시간이 왔습니다. 소개 부탁드려요.
승록이는 일단 저희 팀에서 마지막 주자인 윕이라는 이제 포지션 맡고 있고, 그리고 윕으로서 이제 앞에 말했던 두 연사의 내용을 종합적으로 다시 정리하고, 그리고 상대방의 케이스 중에서 반박이 안 된 부분 이런 것들을 다 정리해서 확실하게 이길 수 있는 우리 팀이 이겼는지를 이제 심판에게 설명해 주는 굉장히 중요한 역할을 맡고 있습니다.
찬성팀의 대들보 여당 원내대표 역을 맡은 이승록 학생의 발언입니다.
Mr. and Madam Speakers, the one clarification upon this point of this debate. The opposition seems to believe that the only dignified human right is only under the rich people's principle, in which when you already have the food, when you already have the good quality of your life, then you should actually live a lengthy time of life. That's a dignified life of human beings. That is exactly why, Mr. and Madam Speaker, first of all, this human dignity that the opposition actually proposes to you is, first of all, not the standard that we should actually consider in this debate. But second of all, Mr. and Madam Speaker, why is that actually a bad thing? We already see in the status quo in the opposition's world how we already put a price tag upon individuals' competition and competitiveness already in the job market and already in many, many bits of our capitalistic society. Our capitalistic society basically works on the idea of meritocracy and works upon the idea of opportunity cost, in which your time also always has a price as well. We've never seen a differentiation between why selling your time directly is extremely different from that case. But second of all, Mr. and Madam Speaker, we think that the subjectivity of happiness comes into a great importance. Why is this so? The reason why we give freedom in itself is because we don't know what's actually happy for these poor people. For some people, length but stable life might be actually a good choice. But others, but a short but happy and an enjoyable life might be worth it. We don't think that the opposition's set world has no justification to tell these individual citizens what values are more important and what values aren't more important. That is why, Mr. and Madam Speaker, we think that the freedom is usually guaranteed. But second of all, Mr. Speaker, the difference between these people simply selling off their time, and like the Native American example about how simply get their money spending on alcohol, is that they make a great sacrifice, Mr. and Madam Speaker. They're not getting this money for free. They do actually also acknowledge the fact that their time is being cut away in this process. That is the exact reason why these poor people also have the incentive to use this time to its fullest potential. That's when our policy also comes into a great importance, Mr. and Madam Speaker. Why? Because in the past, even if the poor could get the money by saving it, they could not allocate it in their best potential because they don't know actually what is the best choice. In our policy in which we have counseling when we actually sell time and tell these poor people, if you really want education, if you really want to escape the system, we'll actually give you such choices, we'll give you advice upon how to do it. This is exactly showing you how these poor people can systematically escape this vicious cycle at the end of the day. Thank you.
여당 원내대표 역의 이승록 학생은 행복의 주관성은 중요한 가치며 정부의 정책이 가난의 악순환을 끊고 사회적 약자에게 선택의 자유를 주리라고 연설했습니다. 반대팀도 반격을 준비하고 있다는데요. 다음 토론자 소개입니다.
저희 팀 윕스피커 체리는 정말 디베이트에서 이기기 위해 뭐가 필요한지를 잘 알고 이걸 위해서는 이런 내용이 필요하다 이런 걸 굉장히 잘 분석하는 친구라서 실제 윕의 특성상 그런 특성들이 굉장히 저희 팀이 이기는데 도움이 많이 되기도 하고 또 그런 면에서 팀의 케이스를 완성하기도 하고 또 실제로 내용을 많이 제공해 주어서 우리 팀이 정말 이길 수 있는 디베이트를 할 수 있도록 약간 포인트를 잘 잡아주는 것 같아요.
반대팀의 구세주가 돼줄 마지막 토론자, 야당 원내총무 역을 맡은 김채리 학생의 발언입니다.
Mr. and Madam Speaker, Team Opposition believes that there are some kind of values that cannot be traded at the end of the day. When we're talking about time in today's debate, it's not simply about time, merely about time, but rather the lifetime which directly impacts your life, directly affects your everyday life, Mr. Speaker. That's why there's an exclusivity of your case. That's why there's an exclusive harm coming from their case, Mr. Speaker, because it's not simply about the time itself, but moreover about the lifetime itself. So furthermore, then they talk about how already the concept of selling time exists in the society and the status quo. We think the clear exclusivity in the case is that we're dealing with the lifetime, as I told you in my introduction, Mr. Speaker. That's why it's an incomparable value. The time selling concept in the status quo is simply decided by the labor qualities, labor condition, Mr. Speaker. We think that is disgusting in a different value. We think that that's incomparable in today's debate. But furthermore, that's when they talk about the difference of organ trading of something that is able to opt in or opt out, and they say that organ trading is something that is not like able to opt in or not. That's why it's actually different to this debate. However, Mr. Speaker, we tell you that selling time is also not able to opt in or not. The reason why it's opting out is extremely difficult in today's discussion. It's because when you actually sell your time, Mr. Speaker, there's no immediate effect coming to you. There's no immediate harm that is coming to you. That's when these kind of people actually sell their time, they do not realize this kind of time has decreased, Mr. Speaker. They do not really acknowledge this kind of detrimental harms that is happening to you. That's why, Mr. Speaker, we think that there's no difference coming from the team government. When we told you parallel examples such as organ trade and slavery and suicide or not, Mr. Speaker, we think that they have never actually proved the difference, but only about opt-in or not. We think that that's the only reason why we actually won this first clash, Mr. Speaker. Therefore, when we actually prove to you why this kind of dignity and this kind of the price tagging of time itself, not only about time and life itself, we think that that itself is the really reason why when we win this kind of first clash. But directly moving on to my second clash about the poor people regarding about the social impact, right? They tell us about how poor people can get out of about this kind of vicious cycle and climb up the social ladder. We tell you people can never get out the vicious cycle because they can never use the money in a rational way. Because they have never touched this kind of large amount of money, they're not able to use this money in a rational way, Mr. Speaker. Therefore, Mr. Speaker, what is rather needed in today's debate is a direct welfare, and a direct education, and a direct subsidy to give the direction for this kind of poor people how they should live their life, Mr. Speaker. That's what the government should go for in today's debate. Furthermore, when the opposition, a government whip talks about the example of Native Americans, we think that that example actually proves to you when this kind of people get a lot of large amount of money at one time, they can never use the money in a rational way. That's why, Mr. Speaker, when the government should actually provide the direct direction and the poor people cannot use the money in a rational way, we think that that's the very reason why the vicious cycle will continue and be repeated in their case, Mr. Speaker. That's why when our team proved to you in today's debate that this kind of like moral and ethnic issue does not actually exist in their case, but furthermore, when they never proved, they can never actually prove to you the reason why this kind of like selling time is that, like, when we tell you of the exclusivity of selling time, Mr. Speaker, they can never actually rebut to their case. That's why I'm very proud to oppose. Thank you.
야당 원내총무역의 김채리 학생은 당장 정책의 위험성을 알긴 어려워도 시간을 사고파는 일은 곧 인생을 사고파는 일이므로 함부로 정책을 시행해선 안 된다고 반박했습니다. 또한 직접적인 복지 제도를 통해 빈부격차 문제를 해소할 수 있다고 주장했는데요. 자, 이젠 각 팀의 최종 발언만 남았습니다. 먼저 야당 측의 최종 발언입니다.
Ladies and gentlemen, we should remember that the fact of sales of time is a zero-sum transaction, meaning if you can buy your time to lengthen your life, it means that someone lost it. That is the direct reason that we can say in today's debate why rich and poor gap can be never solved by their solution of time transaction or whatnot. We're going to further prove to you in my reply speech as well. When individuals are ultimately selling the portion of their lifetime in return for money, we tell you the government should actually be a moral agent and should also must intervene to disallow this moral commercialization of life. This practice is an act of price tagging of human being. Sales of time, including calculating this price value, we tell you this very dangerous message from the get-go. But moreover, ladies and gentlemen, the exclusive problem of time trading differentiated from any other things is that you never feel the aftermath immediately. You can never feel the problem that you lost 10 hours or like 10 years in that immediate moment when you sold your time. We tell you that is a direct reason why people cannot never make rational utilization of money, including poor or rich, but moreover, they're going to simply make a short-sighted choice, not carefully judging consequences. But that is moreover reason when the benefits, all the benefits that the government team could only give in today's debate can never stand, ladies and gentlemen. But moreover, Madam Speaker, the proposition's whole points on benefits to poor could not stand from the get-go of today's debate. Why is this so? It's because they could not have a right characterization, and they started their whole case with a faulty characterization of the main stakeholders that we should consider in today's debate. We tell you, when people can even control their credit card spendings every day and end up in heaps of debt, we think the government in today's debate is simply being so optimistic. They're simply thinking that people are going to use this money in a rational way to invest in their future or whatnot. That is simply not true, because we can see in everyday lives that people are not always that rational in choosing what they're going to use their money upon. But moreover, ladies and gentlemen, we found out that the government team in today's debate could never rebut to our point, our biggest point on rich and poor gap, why when wealthy people will actually buy more time and live forever and invest for their businesses, invest for companies more in that amount of time that they actually bought from this poor people, and they're going to get wealthier. But moreover, poor people are going to lose time, because actually they lost a big amount of time to actually use it for unnecessary expenses, and they cannot really control all the results that will actually happen. Ladies and gentlemen, when in today's debate, when we actually prove to you what human dignity is something that's very absolute, it is not something that is really fluctuative, we tell you that the government team actually also failed to have a moral high ground from the get-go on today's debate. We tell you that government should actually be an actor to stop people from doing these actions, to stop people from actually using money to that includes their lifetime to actually invest in future activities. This is more of a reason why we take this debate home. And thank you for listening.
야당 최종 발언을 맡은 김민진 학생은 이 정책은 삶의 상업화를 부추길 뿐 빈곤층의 혜택은 장담할 수 없으며 인간의 존엄성만 해칠 것이라고 총평했습니다. 그럼 정부 측의 최종 발언입니다.
Ladies and gentlemen, we see the rhetoric of side opposition extremely offensive. Without telling us how poor people will automatically waste money just because poor people are dumb, that was the only narrative that their side of us gave to us. We've told you from the first speaker, basically no one is simply willing to just waste their time when especially our technology also shows you how many remaining time exists, when our deputy speaker argumentation also clearly proved to you when the perception of time also get changed without their side of us intervening, they can never take this debate on. So several issues in this debate. Number one, whether something called time are absolutely right to begin with. We've already told you from our first speaker, basically what's happening in the status quo is time is considered to be an opportunity cost. We've told you how it's a limited resources to begin with, which means that in order for you to have a higher quality of life, that this is, can be utilized for the sake of your opportunity cost, which their side of us never talked about. We've also talked about basically just simply letting these poor people work as a 3D job for the sake of the having a order inside our society. We think that this is also very offensive, like side of ours. They're basically saying that if you're poor people, just leave 70 years working 18 hours a day, or just simply being a slave of your corporation because of your works, where they never provided any mechanisms how they actually allow these poor people to escape from the winner and loser system of the or structure of the capitalism, ladies and gentlemen. Now let's furthermore talk about whether role fulfillment of the government doesn't really takes on whether which side of us, ladies and gentlemen. Number one, we've told you this is beside from welfare. We're not targeting you getting a bread just by having this policy. What we're saying is that although we have a minimum quality of life, there aren't any access for you to go up to the ladder, ladies and gentlemen. We've also talked about, it's not simply you automatically having money. Like for example, if you're willing to have to go to a university, if you're willing to go to have a create a startups, like all of these opportunity costs and the capitals does not exist, ladies and gentlemen. Which means that we are living in a society where it's extremely biased for the rich people, saying the longevity of your life is basically the only yardstick of your own happiness. We think that was extremely marginalizing these poor people who does not even have access to those options. But furthermore, let's talk about rationality of these people. Number one, their simple analysis was they are dumb, which wasn't really explained by their side of us. But furthermore, we bite the bullet because your hope for going to Seoulde also can be a falsive hope, which means that people are responsible for your own life. They never talked about why government should tell. This is the quality of your life. This should be a standard of your life. Simply implement it and injecting. That's a yardstick that we should impose on people, whether that's really a good quality of life, ladies and gentlemen. Because we see that, number one, they never talked about how already in the status quo, how when the money is simply, when the time is also transferred as a money, ladies and gentlemen. But secondly, when they never talked about how they'll automatically solve the problems of capitalism, when our side of us not saying that we're going to solve entire problem, rather at least give them opportunity, while their side of us irresponsibly did nothing, and that's why we take this debate on.
여당 최종 발언을 맡은 조민서 학생은 이 정책을 통해 자본주의가 낳은 빈부격차를 해소할 수 있으며 복지 정책보다 더 실용적인 해결책이 될 수 있다고 총평했습니다. 이렇게 숨가쁘게 달려온 이틀간의 대회가 모두 끝나고 영광의 주인을 기다리는 트로피가 반짝입니다. 2018년 중학생 영어 토론 대회의 우승자는 과연 누구일까요? 팀 트리니티, congratulations! 축하합니다. 올해 제너럴리그의 챔피언은 트리니티. 한편 국내파 학생들의 리그인 EFL 부문에서 코스모스팀이 우승을 차지했습니다.
부장님께서 수고해 주시겠습니다. 연금 50만 원이 필요해요.
팀끼리 같이 열심히 해가지고 좋은 결과 낼 수 있어서 되게 기뻐요. 그리고 팀끼리 같이 그동안 열심히 한 거 보상받는 기분이에요.
사실 2등 한 것도 굉장히 기쁜데 그 마음보다 피곤해서 집에 가서 쉬고 싶은 마음이 좀 더 큰 것 같아요.
최선을 다한 만큼 힘들고 지칠 때도 있었지만 가슴속의 포부와 열정을 고스란히 보여준 이틀간의 여정이었습니다. 지금처럼 웃는 얼굴로 더 넓은 세상을 향해 당당히 걸어나가길, 영어 토론 대회가 청소년 여러분의 꿈을 응원합니다.